Hi everyone, here in this lecture I am going to deal about maternal pelvis, and this is the important topic for practical purpose in all the nursing courses. So maternal pelvis is a gynecoid type in which the pelvic brim is rounded structure which is formed anteriorly by the symphysis pubis, posteriorly by the sacrum and the coccyx, and laterally it is formed by two hip bones, and hip bone is formed by three bones which is fused later on, and these are the superior portion, it is formed by the ilium, the lower or inferior portion is formed by ischium, and the anterior portion is formed by pubic bone. So this is termed as pelvic girdle because it creates contact between axial skeletal system with the appendicular skeletal system. So here in this lecture, I am going to deal about the various aspects of maternal pelvis, in which there are the bones, joints, ligaments, the diameters which are showing the relationship with the fetus. So let's have a look on the bones. There are the two hip bones which is formed by the ilium, ischium and the pubic bone. So first we talk about the ilium. So ilium forms the flared part which is present on the superior aspect, and its superior border is formed the iliac crest which ends at the blunt end, and it is termed as anterior superior iliac spine, and just below to that is the another spine is anterior inferior iliac spine, and posteriorly this iliac crest end at the posterior superior iliac spine, and lower it ends with the posterior inferior iliac spine, and there is a notch on the posterior aspect, and this notch is termed as greater sciatic notch, through which the greatest nerve in our body, that is sciatic nerve, passes. On the posterior aspect there is a roughened area and it is termed as iliac tuberosity, and this part is give attachment for the various muscles. Then the medial or the anterior surface forms a depressed portion which is termed as iliac fossa, and inferior to iliac fossa is one line which runs superiorly or anteriorly, and it is the arcuate line. Later on it has got a clinical significance because it forms an important landmark in pelvic brim. And medially there is an articulating area in this ilium which articulate with the sacrum and form the strongest joint in the body, that is sacroiliac joint. This ilium has got two part. The superior part is termed as ala, and the inferior part is termed as body, which attaches with the ischium. So the next part comes the ischium. Ischium has got two parts, the body which consists of the roughened portion, and it is termed as ischial tuberosity, and superior to that is, or anterior to that is, the ramus, and this ramus and the pubic bone forms a opening, and this is termed as obturator foramen, which is covered by the obturator membrane through which blood vessels and nerve passes. And posterior to ischium is one projection is there, and it is termed as ischial spine, and it has got clinical significance through which you can easily assess the station of head. The anterior hip bone is formed by pubic bone, and pubic bone has got three part, the superior ramus, the inferior ramus and the body part. The body part where the two rami are meet together. The anterior border of the pubic bone is the pubic crest. Slightly lateral to that is the pubic tubercle, and from pubic tubercle there is a line which runs posteriorly or laterally is the pectineal line, which later on merge with this arcuate line and form iliopectineal line. Together the three bones, hip bone, that is the pubic, ischium or ilium, forms a cup or socket like structure, and this is the acetabulum, and this is a socket like structure through which the head of the femoris attaches or articulate with it so that you can easily move your limb in any of the direction. And there is a notch over here, and it is termed as acetabular notch, through which blood vessels and nerve enters or exit. So here we have seen the three hip bones, and it is formed by the ilium, that is the superior flared part, ischium, that is the inferior and posterior part through which you can easily sit, and the anterior portion, which is formed by the two pubic bone. Then comes the posterior aspect of pelvic bone, which is the part of axial skeletal system, that is the sacrum. And the sacrum is the triangular shaped bone, and the sacrum is formed by five fused vertebra, and the anterior border is smooth and curved, and in female this bone is wider or shorter. Posteriorly it is more roughened area because it gives attachment for the various muscles. The superior broader part of the sacrum is termed as base, and the inferior narrow portion is termed as apex. On this superior part there is anteriorly projected structure, and it is termed as sacral promontory, and posteriorly there are two articulating surface area which attaches with the lumbar vertebra and forms lumbosacral joint. And on the lateral aspect there are two auricular shaped structure which extends laterally from the sacral promontory, and these are termed as sacral ala. Anteriorly there are four transverse line, and these transverse lines showing the fusion of vertebral bodies of sacrum, and at the end of this transverse line there are the four pair of anterior foraminas, and these foraminas are continuation with the posterior foraminas through which blood vessels or nerve enter or exit. Posteriorly on the medial aspect in the sacrum there is a sacral crest, and it is formed by the fusion of spinous process of the sacral vertebras, and it gives attachment for the ligaments or the muscles. At the apex part of the sacrum there is one opening, and it is termed as sacral hiatus, and it is continuation with the sacral canal, and this sacral canal is continuous with the vertebral column. And on the either side of this hiatus or opening are the two projections, and it gives attachment for the ligaments to connect it with the coccyx. So it is a triangular shaped bone. It forms a part of axial skeletal system which connect the sacrum to the ilium and form the strongest joint, sacroiliac joint. And lower to that is one triangular shaped bone is termed as coccyx, and it is formed by four fused vertebra, and this coccyx is attaches with the sacrum by the sacrococcygeal joint. So the broader part of this coccyx is termed as base, and the pointed end portion is termed as apex. On the posterior aspect there are the coccygeal cornua, and these cornua attaches with the ligament with the sacrum. And in female this coccyx is directed inferiorly, and this joint is more flexible in female so that fetus can easily pass through it. So here in this model we have seen the bones, and the bones are the two hip bones, ilium, ischium and the pubic bone, and posteriorly there is one sacrum and one coccyx. Now comes the joint, and the joints are the point where the two bones meet together, and there is one symphysis pubis, and it is present in between the two pubic bone, and there are the paired sacroiliac joint. So it articulate the sacrum with the ilium on both sides, so it is the strongest joint in the body, sacroiliac joint. And there is one sacrococcygeal joint which is more flexible in female, as it provides room to the pelvic outlet so that fetus can easily pass through it. Next comes the ligaments, and these are the structure which helps the joint together, and there is one interpubic ligament which attaches or which is present in between the two pubic bone, and it is fibrocartilaginous disc. There are the various sacroiliac ligament which are present on the anterior and the posterior aspect, which held the sacroiliac joint together, and there is sacrococcygeal ligament which attaches the sacrum to the coccyx, and it is also present on the anterior or the posterior aspect. And another two are the sacrotuberous ligament, and it extends from the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, so sacrotuberous ligament. And there are the sacrospinous ligament which attaches the sacrum to the ischial spine on the both side. So these are the ligaments. There is very limited movement in between the joints in non-pregnant state, but at the time of pregnancy, because of the release of hormone, causes the ligaments to be softened and increases the presenting diameter of the pelvis, so that the fetus can easily accommodate the pelvic canal and it can easily pass through it. Next comes the difference between false pelvis and true pelvis. And in false pelvis, there is no exact pelvic measurement, and it is bounded posteriorly by the lumbar vertebra, laterally by the iliac crest and the iliac fossa, or anteriorly by the anterior abdominal wall. So you can't measure it precisely, but it gives support to the uterus at the time of pregnancy. But in the true pelvis, it has got the exact pelvic measurement, and it has three parts, that is the pelvic brim. So I am pointing the marks. So this area is termed as the pelvic brim or the inlet. Then comes the cavity, and it is round structure and forms the curved canal. And the last bony region is termed as pelvic outlet. First we deal about the pelvic brim or the inlet, and this is the area where the fetus come in contact with the maternal pelvis. So there are the various bony points on this, and these are termed as landmark. So from anterior to posterior, there are the 9 landmarks, and these are upper border of symphysis pubis, pubic crest, pubic tubercle, pectineal line, iliopectineal eminence, iliopectineal line, sacroiliac joint, anterior border of sacral ala, and the sacral promontory. So these 9 landmarks are same in both side, and this area is termed as pelvic brim or inlet. The next comes the pelvic cavity, and it is rounded structure which is bounded above by the pelvic brim and below by the obstetrical outlet. And the last bony part is the pelvic outlet. So here we'll discuss about the diameters of these all three parts. So in pelvic brim, there are the three diameters, and these are anterior posterior diameter, transverse diameter, and the oblique diameter. So in the anterior posterior diameter, there are the again three diameters, and these are true conjugate, or you can say anatomical conjugate, the obstetric conjugate, and the diagonal conjugate. So first we deal the true or anatomical conjugate, and this is the distance between the midpoint of sacral promontory till the upper border of symphysis pubis, and this measures about 11 centimeter. Then comes the obstetric conjugate. And the obstetric conjugate is the exact space available for the fetus to pass through pelvic brim and enters into the pelvic cavity. So this point extends from midpoint of sacral promontory to the midline of symphysis pubis, where a projection is there in the middle, till the point is end up. So this distance is about 10 centimeter. Next comes the diagonal conjugate, and this is the distance from midpoint of sacral promontory till the lower border of symphysis pubis. Here it is. So it is about 12 centimeter. So this diagonal conjugate has got clinical significance because you can easily measure it through bimanual examination. The next diameter in pelvic brim is the oblique diameter, and these are the two, right and left. Right indicate the right side of the maternal pelvis, and it starts from right sacroiliac joint till the opposite side of iliopectinal eminence. It means the left side. So it is about 12 cm, and the left oblique diameter extends from left sacroiliac joint till right iliopectinal eminence. So these are the same both side, left and right. The third diameter is transverse diameter, and the transverse diameter extends from the farthest point between the two iliopectinal line. So it is the widest diameter in pelvic brim. This measures about 13 cm. Next comes the pelvic cavity. This cavity is formed by a curved canal in which the anterior depth is about 4 cm, which is formed by symphysis pubis, and its posterior depth is formed by sacrum and coccyx, which is curved, and it is about 12 cm. So altogether it forms the curved canal, and it is round in structure. Its anterior posterior diameter extends from the junction of second or third sacral vertebra, here it is, till the midpoint of symphysis pubis, here it is the midpoint of symphysis pubis, and this measuring about 12 cm. Its transverse diameter or oblique diameter cannot be measured exactly because the points are overlying to the soft tissues. So you can say roughly the overall diameter of this pelvic cavity is about 12 cm. Next comes the last bony part, that is the pelvic outlet, in which there are the two conjugates, and these are obstetrical conjugate and anatomical conjugate. And in obstetrical conjugate there are the two diameters, and the anterior posterior diameter in obstetrical conjugate extends from the tip of sacrum to the lower border of symphysis pubis. So it is the anterior posterior diameter, and it is about 11 cm. The transverse diameter of obstetrical conjugate is bispinous diameter, and it extends in between the two ischial spines, and it is about 10.5 cm. In the true or anatomical conjugate, the anterior posterior diameter extends from the tip of coccyx till the lower border of symphysis pubis, and it measures about 13 cm, and its transverse diameter extends in between the inner border of ischial tuberosity, and it is about 11 cm. So the obstetrical conjugate has a clinical importance because this is the exact pelvic outlet through which the fetus must pass. So here in this video we have seen the practical aspect of maternal pelvis, and this pelvic bone forms a bridge between the axial skeletal system with the appendicular skeletal system, and here the sacrum and coccyx form the axial skeletal system part, and the femur, which attaches with the acetabulum, forms the part of appendicular skeletal system. So these three hip bones form a bridge like structure which create a contact between axial with the appendicular skeletal system, and it also protects the female internal genital organs which lies inside the pelvic cavity. So thank you for watching this video. Please subscribe our channel, and for more lectures you can visit our site.